Welcome to Invocations, a virtual performance by the Minnesota Philharmonic Orchestra. My name is Brian Dowdy. I'm the artistic director and principal conductor of the MPO. Tonight's program is about resilience, about how we respond to adversity and loss, about our capacity for courage, hope, creativity, and joy. Some of the music you'll hear tonight is full of energy. Some of it creates an uncanny stillness, and some of it is gently and generously uplifting. Our musicians join you tonight from their homes to share music by Anthony R. Green, Rafe Vaughan Williams, William Grant Still, Lillian Fuchs, Ryan Brown, and Jean Sibelius. We also have two special guest composers with us, here to introduce you to their music and the stories behind it. We begin with one of those composers, Anthony R. Green, to introduce his piece, Catto's Courage.
Catto's Courage was commissioned by the celebrity series Boston in partnership with Castle of Our Skins for a performance in 2020 that was unfortunately canceled because of the pandemic. However, the piece was premiered digitally, and I am super, super grateful for that opportunity. Catto's Courage is based on the life of Octavius Catto, who was an intellectual, a civil rights activist, and just a wonderful, wonderful thinker who lived in the Philadelphia area. He was born in 1839, and he died in 1871, just 32 years old. But during the 32 years of his life, he definitely packed a punch and made such a big impact. He, for instance, helped Frederick Douglass enlist Black soldiers to fight in the Civil War. There's even a story about his civil disobedience when he stepped onto a trolley car, and because other people didn't want him to be on that trolley car because of the color of his skin, he was asked to leave, but he refused to leave. So all of the passengers got out the car. The conductor was afraid that he would be fined for forcefully kicking out Catto, because that was the practice. So the conductor basically unhinged the car from the system and drove the trolley car off the track and let Octavius Catto just sit there alone. And Catto apparently stayed on this car for more than 24 hours. And that action alone led to the desegregation of the trolley system in Philadelphia. Octavius Catto did so, so much more. And unfortunately, on election day in 1871, he was accosted by a racist Irish man. At that time, the Irish Democrats were vehemently against Black Republicans voting. And unfortunately, this Irish man shot Octavius Catto on election day, and that's how Catto passed away. However, the year before that, the 15th Amendment was passed, which gave the right to vote to Black men in the United States. Women at the time, all women, didn't have suffrage, but that 15th Amendment was passed partly because of the activism that Octavius Catto had done in the previous years leading up to the passing of the 15th Amendment. So with that, I decided to write a piece to pay honor and tribute to the courage that this 32-year-old man had in his life. And I can't actually imagine the courage that he had. I am older than 32 right now and haven't achieved nearly as much as Catto did. And he was working in such an oppressive system. So when I came across this story, I was just so bawled over at this activism and the success of Octavius Catto. And it was really such an honor to be able to write a piece that pays tribute to his work. With that, enjoy Catto's courage. Thank you.
William Grant Still was an African-American composer who was born in 1895 and died in 1978. He's noted for many firsts, including becoming the first African-American to conduct a major symphony in the United States and to have an opera produced by a major American company. He began his career playing popular music on the violin, cello, and oboe in the commercial orchestras of the day. He pursued composition studies at the New England Conservatory and became a noted and influential composer in his own lifetime, writing over 150 compositions, including the lovely little piece for oboe that I'll play this evening, the Incantation and Dance. I want to thank my collaborative pianist, orchestra member Kenneth Kusiak, for his beautiful playing. I hope you enjoy the piece.
Thank you.
In 1927, Ralph Vaughan Williams composed a song cycle based on texts by English poet A.E. Housman. Those texts use the natural imagery of moons, morning light, forests, and open fields to paint scenes of uncertainty, loss, grief and hope, and occasional joy. For his musical setting of those texts, Vaughan Williams chose an unusual pairing of soprano and violin, interwoven as equal melodic partners, acting in turn as accompanist and soloist.
Thank you. Hi, my name is Jon Poupore, and I'm delighted to be playing three Caprices by Lillian Fuchs for you. Lillian Fuchs was a monument, a pillar of the 20th century viola, and she was an extensive chamber music player and soloist, and she was sister to the violinist Joseph Fuchs, who was also a composer and conductor and performer. They oftentimes performed together, usually playing Mozart duos or the Mozart Symphonic Concertante, and the Three Madrigals by Martinu were also dedicated to them, and they performed that often. She was a major pedagogue, as I said, and most players, well-known players from the mid to late 20th century studied with her either as a performer or as a chamber music coach, and that often took place at the Aspen Music Festival. Fuchs composed three books of virtuosic etudes, all of which are still in regular use in studios and across the world. These are three etudes from the Book of 12 Caprices, and they flow seamlessly from one to the next. Thank you for listening.
Hi everyone, my name is Ryan Brown. I'm the composer of The Light by Which She May Have Ascended, which was composed in early 2004 in memory of my grandmother who had passed away a few months before that. The piece more or less came to me all at once, at least the idea, which is very simple, of having four lines that are rising and descending, but never quite falling back to the same starting point. So they're always kind of going up and three steps forward, two steps back kind of thing, until they all converge up at the top. And, you know, it deliberately has, I think, an ambiguous feeling of hope and sadness, which was what I was feeling after she had passed away. But I think culminating in kind of a bright arrival point for all the lines at the top. I hope you enjoy it.
Thank you.
In 1922, Finnish composer Jean Sibelius wrote a string quartet called Andante Festivo. And 16 years later, he rescored that work for string orchestra and timpani. Then, on the 1st of January in 1939, Sibelius himself conducted the premiere of that version in a live worldwide radio broadcast in celebration of the New York World Exhibition. It was, as New York Times critic Olin Downs put it, Finland's greeting to the world. That was Sibelius' last performance as a conductor. And in 1957, the piece was performed at his funeral, a stirring and joyful tribute to Finland's most celebrated composer.
Thank you.
Thanks for joining us for Invocations. We return to the virtual stage on May 5th for Bartók in the Bronx, a virtual pop-up concert featuring duets by Béla Bartók and Violet Archer, performed by Catherine Himmerich and Joe Dolson. Our season then concludes on June 19th with Transformations, at which we premiere House of Circus, a brand new work by Saba Aminikia, performed in collaboration with students from the Sirkhana Social Circus School. Thank you again, and see you soon.